Good morning. Welcome to Holy Cross. I'm Pastor Dennis Bartles, and it's so great to see you here this morning. And not under these circumstances, but at the same time, we celebrate a life today. And that's why we gathered here. God gives us that opportunity. And through a tragic accident, there's still good. And today we come and ask God to help us. And we gather to remember an amazing man, a gentle giant. Ever see his hands? They were huge. I thought I had big hands. He was born in Carroll City, Florida on December 19th in 1952, joined the church triumphant on July 3rd, 2023. Today's a celebration to worship God because it's appropriate to do so even on the occasion of death. Because it's God who gives life and sets the limits under which life is to be lived and promises eternal life through his son, Jesus Christ, a promise that John knew and lived each day. And today, Jesus is here in this place to lead us and guide us and unite us as a body of Christ. Today, we also gather to remember John, one of God's special people, a husband to Terry for almost 42 years, the love of his life, his Dairy Queen. Father has three sons, Johnny and Billy and Mark. He gave you his heart, he gave you his love, his compassion, and he even gave you his hair. Recently, due to marriage, he became a father-in-law and was blessed with now with two daughters, Kelly and Katie. The two of you just brought life to him and a new experience, and it made him smile all the time. And his most recent role as a grandfather to Noah Rose, his number one girl, his buddy, and he would do anything for her. John tried each day to live his life to the fullest by making life more pleasant for others, especially to you, his family. His words and actions exemplify that he was truly a man of God. And thirdly, we here to support one another, and especially you, his family. He wasn't John or Dad, he was also known as Poppy. And when you ask how he got the name, it deals with his love for dogs. And when his boys got their dogs, they became his grand dogs, and they started calling him Poppy. I thought it was some other reason, but it was all because of his dogs. He was blessed with his siblings, Happy and Paul, who preceded him, but also blessed with his brother Frank and his sister Joyce. Joyce is not able to be here today because of dealing with a recovery from an illness. And then there's lots of nieces and nephews and cousins and relatives from Georgia. How special it is that you made the trip down to be here today. Thank you for coming and making this a true celebration. And may this day be filled with lots of love and memories as we share memories with each other. And yesterday we're here and we're in the right place. So welcome in the name of Jesus, and may this be a special time for us all as we celebrate the life of John Peterson. There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. In holy baptism, John Peterson already died to sin and was born into eternal life. Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too may live a new life. And if we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. Amen. Alleluia. The hymn Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Thank you.
Stunned by this sudden loss, seeking the counsel of your truth, the strength of your presence, and the guidance of your wisdom. And we especially present ourselves in this place to give honor to the memory of John. We traveled to this place from many different locations by many different routes, and from a variety of experiences as numerous as our own individual journeys. We're not used to being together under these circumstances, and most of us are not used to being in this place. So it's all the more our prayer that you, O God, will unite us in heart and mind and spirit for this little while, that our lives might be touched by the promise of your life as it has been revealed to us through Jesus Christ. If emotion wells up in us, accept our tears as tokens for our love for John. And with those tears, release from us a burdensome grief until at last we might truly celebrate his life. And then, O God, by your Spirit, strengthen us in the service of your realm, that at the last we might be truly worthy to bear your name and experience the fullness of your grace together with all the saints who from their labors rest. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Our first reading today comes from the book of Isaiah, the 20th chapter, beginning with verse 28. The prophet writes, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He gives strength to the earth. He will not grow weary or tired or weary, and he gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." We turn to the book of Deuteronomy now, chapter 31, verse 8. And there it says, "The Lord himself goes before you, and he will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you, so do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." And then, because John was a mason and a builder, we go to Hebrews chapter 3, where you get verses 3 and 4. "He has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses, just as the builder of a house has greater honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything." And John understood that. I invite you now to read with me the 23rd Psalm, a psalm that tells us how the Lord meets every one of our needs, and he truly did meet every one of John's needs. And we read this, the psalm together. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then we go to the book of John, the 14th chapter, where Jesus gives us words of comfort. And he says, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house is many rooms, and if that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. But Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how do we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We now invite Cousin Joey to come up to read her poem.
I have the honor of reading a poem that's been compiled by Master William Peterson, by Billy Peterson, and my sister and I, on behalf of our mom, Uncle John's sister, that's not able to be here, but she sends her love to all of you. And this poem is titled Mason's Heart.
Speak it louder.
Okay.
The mic is.
I truly was a brick mason.
Well, you know what? It's not going to work.
I really
you
session.
Want to do it, or they'll give you a mic.
I can speak loud enough so everyone can hear. That's easy. Okay. So the name of this poem is A Mason's Heart. In memory of the loving Father's grace, a mason's heart, now in a better place. He toiled with strength, with hands so skilled. His love for family, his heart fulfilled. With three sons dear and a granddaughter's queen, he held them close like a cherished dream. A life of love he tenderly embraced. Through every challenge, his spirit encased. A gentle giant, towering with care, his presence calming, a love so rare. The taste of ice cream on warm summer eves, a sweet connection his heart believes. For in a Dairy Queen, fate intercedes, and there he found the love he'd never conceived. He met his wife, whose heart was pure, their love enduring, a bond secure. He built and fixed with a craftsman's flair, a legacy strong beyond compare. In every structure, his passion shone, a testament of love, now he's flown. Yet his greatest joy, a sight to behold, was the time spent with family, the stories retold. A beacon of kindness, he'd lend a hand, helping others, his purpose grand. In the face of trials, he stood so tall, never cussed nor complained, in grace stood small, with patience profound, he calmed the storm, his gentle spirit and a heart so warm. Now he's gone, but his love lives on. In memories cherished, even though he's gone. A loving father,
a role model rare, leaving prints of love everywhere. In every brick laid, in every repair, his love and presence forever share. Though he's no longer here, his spirit's near. A loving father will always hold dear.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, dear Christian friends. This is not an easy day. And I want to begin to say how sorry I am to you, Terry, and the boys, Johnny and Billy and Mark and Kelly and Katie and little Noah and the cousins and brother and sister. And as we gather here today, we didn't expect to be here. And I wish I could take your sorrow away, but I know I can't. It was a tragic accident, and we could spend all kinds of time wondering why and asking all kinds of questions, but the answers, they're not going to come, at least not the way we want them to come. We are taught that when disaster occurs, we're to dial 911. It's emergency. And today, that's kind of where we're all at, and so we do call 911. Because the loss of a loved one is probably the most difficult time in the life of an individual. And grief is never easy or comfortable. And sometimes it seems almost unbearable. So are you willing to dial 911 with me this morning? Because we go to Psalm 91, verse 1. And if you ever get in trouble, Psalm 91 is one of the best psalms there is. But there it says in verse 1, and I'm going to add verse 2. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God and my trust. There once was a family, and in this case, the wife died of cancer when she was in her 30s, leaving three small children under the age of 12. Her husband was a pastor, and he decided that he was going to lead the funeral himself. So what does a father tell his motherless children at that time? On his way to the service, he was driving with his little family when a large truck passed him on the highway, casting a shadow over the whole car. The father turned to his oldest daughter, who was staring out the window, and he asked, "Tell me, sweetheart, would you rather be run over by the truck or its shadow?" The little girl looked curiously at her father and said, "By the shadow, I guess, because it can't hurt." The father then quietly said to the three children, "Your mother has not been overrun by death, but by the shadow of death, and there is nothing to fear." I guess that's where we start this morning when I talk to you, the family and the friends of John. He also has not been run over by death, but by the shadow of death. There is nothing to fear. And our enemy, the devil, wants to fill our hearts with fear, but as we heard from 9:1:1, Psalm 91, verse 1, the devil will not succeed. The Bible says, it doesn't say not to grieve. It's part of life. It says that if a Christian dies, we don't grieve as those who have no hope. And today we gather here as people of hope, not wishing, but we know two very distinct things. That John is in heaven right now. And secondly, we're going to see him again. Why? Because he loved the Lord Jesus, and now Jesus has embraced him and carried him to his heavenly home. And so that's what brings us here today. And all kinds of thoughts and memories are going through your mind about Big John. Well, he wasn't Big Bad John, he was Big Good John. I want your help this morning. I want you just to kind of popcorn style, just shout out a word or a phrase that reminds you of John. What would you say if you had to describe him to somebody? Hey, it loud.
Caring.
Role model.
Humble.
Smiling. Shy.
Hard working.
Always there.
Grandpa.
Good friend.
Weatherman.
Weatherman. Like that one.
Dedicated.
Good storyteller.
And he was. Once you got him talking, he could tell you all kinds of stories. Good memories, aren't they? John was kind. He was strong, he was gentle. I already mentioned he had these big, huge hands. He had a great head of hair. And he had a bigger than big heart. He was a shy man until he retired. He loved to tell jokes to his family. He knew when he was going to say it by the way he set you up. When he retired, he became a social butterfly, and he blossomed talking to everyone. He truly enjoyed his retirement. He became known as the mayor of his community, the keeper of the keys, the collector of the mail. How many of you seen the movie Otto? He was the Otto of the neighborhood. He took in all the trash cans. Someone even called him the Superman because he came to everybody's rescue. And he knew it was Christmas when the star got up on the tree. He was hardworking. He worked on many of the buildings in downtown Miami and around the area. He was part of building the Marlins Stadium, and if you go there, you can see his name on the wall engraved. He loved his family, a lover of people, loved his dogs. In fact, you usually would see a dog on his lap. And these were not lap dogs. Especially Dakota. He was a straight shooter. He was a servant, a great neighbor, a friend to all. His life experiences were a book in and of themselves, and his wisdom and love for others made him a true friend, and as you said, a role model. He was a man with a smile that made you feel like you knew him for years, even if you just met him for the first time. And like I said, his heart was so big. And the bottom line, I believe, is that John saw himself as a person who had been put here to touch people and to make things work. He was a man too blessed to be stressed. As marriage and family were important to him, making sure his boys had everything they needed, often out of the blue, he would just show up at your houses with lawn equipment in the truck or tools that he sensed something was broken, and he was there to fix it even though you hadn't called him yet. Except if you were Kelly. Kelly called him, "Poppy, something's broke," or "This is broke," and Mark wouldn't even know that she'd call him. His greatest joy, though, was finding something that had been discarded by somebody and picking it out of the trash, bringing it to his house and fixing it up and then giving it to somebody else. And he was especially happy when he could fix Noah's little JJ doll. On fall pickup day, where would John be? He'd be out there with the city guys, help loading their trucks, and then giving them all a Gatorade. He always had a gift of making things work. He loved you, Terry, but he knew how to push your buttons too. Like the day he went to Publix to buy a lottery ticket, and he walked by and he goes to the clerk and he says, "I want the winning ticket." She just smiles and said, "Everybody wants a winning ticket." He said, "No, I want the winning ticket." And then he pointed to the sign, "Satisfaction guaranteed." He said, "If I don't win this ticket, I want my money back." Terry just kept on walking. Didn't acknowledge him to be your husband at all. One of his greatest memories was the Alaskan cruise with his family, seeing the sights and being there with each other. But getting ready for the trip was another whole story. Terry, as you know, was a couponer and has a room full of all kinds of things, more than anyone could ever use. But he needed deodorant. He went out and bought, the dollar store bought all kinds of deodorant, and she comes home and she says, "Why'd you do that? I don't want to smell like a woman." Manly scent, even though the Old Spice was there. But he knew how to touch you and make you laugh. He loved his country, his world, his family, and his neighbors, and in it all, it was evident that he was a man just too blessed to be stressed. He grew up in a time when things were expected of individuals, and he stressed to all who surrounded him that each and every one of us was here to achieve and to do our best, always giving praise and honor to a living God. If you did wrong, he had a special way of telling you. He did not let anything stress him. Rather, in tough times, would always see the blessings that were there surrounding him. John's work ethic was that everyone had a part to play and everyone had a pitch in. That's how you made things work. One of his greatest joys was his home, and no matter what was needed, he would put all of his effort to make sure his place was in order. And not only his, but of course his boys' homes too. And those big hands, they were never idle. One of his greatest joys was his yard, and you would often see him with his Home Depot bucket weeding the yard. He'd spend hours on his hands and knees just pulling weeds. People would walk by or ride their bicycles by and often would say, "You can come to my yard and pull weeds." And he said, "Okay, I will do that as soon as I finish here." But then he would add, "But you see, every day new weeds pop up, so I'm never finished here." And they would continue to pull weeds. John also was a coin collector. Not collecting coins to put in books. He just collected coins. And you look around the house, there's jars of coins everywhere. This is the nickel jar, this is the different jar, this is the penny jar. And those jars are full. He collected lots of coins. He called them pennies from heaven. And those pennies have been showing up to these family over these past few days, especially the girls. Noah was the first to find a penny. And then Kelly, and then Katie, and you, Terry. And in those moments, you were reminded of John. We thank God for those moments. And I guarantee each one of you, you're all going to find pennies today if you look around. Just go down to the reception. And when you find that penny, may it bring you joy and put a smile on your face as you think of John. A servant is who John was, and he lived in all aspects of his life, a man too blessed to be stressed. He was committed to serving the Lord and understanding that life was a gift and to be shared. He touched all ages and all cultures, and everyone felt comfortable around him. And as his neighbor said, we were family too. He was in the Bible a lot. He loved to read his Bible. He believed that Jesus died on that rugged cross and that his sins were forgiven. And because of that, he had a peace about him that you just, when you were in his presence, you felt peace. He knew he had a God who took care of every one of his needs, and he wanted to make sure that everyone understood the 23rd Psalm. And with the Lord by his side, he lived his life as a man who was too blessed to be stressed. It is said that the average person in a lifetime will touch 10,000 people, but I know John has touched many more than that, and his influence is in all of us and who we are because we were touched by him. Stories, friends, family, work, serving to show a world who thinks that they're old or entitled. John says, "No, I'm not old anything, and I'm not entitled to nothing." The reality is, life is to be lived to the fullest, to helping others and being a servant. And in the process, you realize what life is really about. And that every day, God gives you resources you're to use. You use them to bless and to make things work. And when you do that, you're just too blessed to be stressed. John wanted this to be a celebration, and that is what we're doing today, celebrating and thanking God for John. John's story is amazing, though because some people struggle through life trying to make it work and don't succeed. John was amazing because he was blessed in all stages of his life, and he made it all work. As a young boy, as a husband, as a father, as a grandfather, employee, neighbor, friend, the list goes on. He was just truly a man who was too blessed to be stressed. But I stand before you to tell you John's secret. John was not a self-made man. He was blessed with the understanding that God lived in him, God lived with him, and God lived through him. And the knowledge of Jesus was alive in him as he lived his faith daily. He was always trying to find something he could do so he could help others see the Lord's blessings. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, he was an instrument of God and made things work. In 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7, it talks about common clay jars. I guess our common clay jars today would be Ziploc bags. They last for a while, and then you just cast them away. Paul says, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us." Here the treasure he is talking about is the plain truth about God's mercy and the light of the gospel of glory of Jesus Christ, who is the image of God. But then he goes on and says, he says, we are not hard pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may be revealed in our body. To his last breath, John fought the good fight, and he kept the faith, giving all the glory to God. For it was Christ who made it all work. And through the cross, John found the forgiveness of his sins and the joy of knowing that the victory of the resurrection of Jesus was his as Jesus lived in him and with him and through him. And that is the joy we celebrate today, because that gift is ours too. For Jesus has given it to us if we only believe in him. John did just that, and he wants each and every one of us to realize the blessings that are found in Jesus. Jesus, what a beautiful name. A name that helps us on days like this. For Jesus is here, surrounding us with his arms and his love and his power. Jesus, the one who walked on the water, who calmed the storms, who fed the hungry, who healed the sick, and even raised the dead. Jesus, the greatest funeral director ever, because every funeral he went to, the person came alive. And Jesus is here with us right now. And I pray that you see him, that you feel his presence, because Jesus has got John in his presence right now. And Jesus is here today saying to you and me, come, you who are weary, you who are burdened, and I will give you rest. Along with comfort and rest, God offers each of us peace today, because we are all certain of one thing. Right now, John wouldn't change one single thing. Today, our God tells us, do not be afraid, for I'm with you. Do not be dismayed, for I'm your God, and I'll hold you with my victorious right hand. Because you see, Jesus made those promises to all of us, including John. He told us not to worry. He's got it in his hands. And Jesus fulfilled every one of those promises to John, and right now he's fulfilling them with us. And right now, John is seeing his Lord and Savior face to face. And John doesn't even need a level anymore or a trowel anymore, because every brick and every mortar is perfect and laid just right. And he's just smiling from ear to ear. And that's what the Bible says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the one of his saints. So God fulfilled every promise he ever made to John. He fulfilled the promises to us too, of comfort and rest and hope and strength and peace. But God has given us one more thing, and that's what I want you to remember this morning. And that is our memory of John. Remember how happy he made you. But just as important, remember how happy you made him. And how happy he is right now. And remember this, God the Father lost his son on a cross but was reunited 3 days later. And if we believe in Jesus, there will come a day when we will be reunited with him, never to be separated again. The Bible says we've been made endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And there's no need to erect a monument for John, because God already has done it in heaven, a place that he's prepared for him. But looking around the room this morning with you, the people who knew John and loved him, one thing becomes very clear. If life is measured by what is left behind, the life of John Peterson was a very successful life. Yes, there's only one John in this world, and we are blessed because we knew him and we loved him. And that's what we celebrate today, a man who made things work, a man who taught us the importance of being too blessed to be stressed. One more thing, John did love to eat. And he had this tendency of, when he went out to eat, he had the tendency of taking a fork and putting it in his pocket. And then Jerry would say, I got home and there's forks all over the place. What do you do this for? Well, the story is told of a woman who was dying. He called her pastor to her side, and he says, I want you, told her what the service he wanted and the songs wanted. And as he was getting ready to leave, she said, I want you to do one more thing. I want you to bury me with a fork. And he says, what? And when people ask, to say yes, because he says, I remember what all the restaurants or all the places or socials we go to, they, when they came to pick a couple of dishes, they would say, keep your fork. The best is yet to come. And today, the best is yet to come, because that love of Jesus is with us, and there's more forks for everybody in the hall. If you want a fork, just know this. The Lord loves you, and the Lord is with you, and I'll let you pass them out to the rest of the family, Mark. And he also believed in this. Retired, not my problem anymore. Yes, we have a lot to celebrate, a lot to share. And with that, we celebrate the life of John. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we have a time of family remembrances, and I'm going to invite Happy to come up first. And here's the microphone. Let's try this one. Testing, one, two. Check, check, check. Is it working?
I've got a pretty big voice. So
check. I don't know. It doesn't sound very like it's working. Can I mute it?
Can you hear me okay? All right. I got a big voice. I'm okay. Thank you so much. Thanks, Aunt Terry, for letting me do this. So I'm a nephew. Johnny is my uncle. And his brother, Paul, passed away. Dad passed away 6 months ago. And they were, it was carbon copies of each other. I mean, they were absolute. My mom wishes she could be here. The health is just not good. And she loved, the last 6 months, she has loved Johnny calling her. Because every Friday, he didn't miss it. Because, he reminds her of Dad so much. And so it's just so comforting for her. And I mean, just carbon copies of each other, the big hands, the big, just everything about him, big and generous and kind and all those things. Except for the mustache. My dad had a mustache. And John didn't, but I saw the picture of the beard. That was a little odd. If I'm being honest. I hadn't seen that before. And was there some red in it?
Yeah.
Ah, where I get it. Very nice. It's true, us Petersons have gray hair. Thank you for acknowledging that. Yeah, we do have. There's a bunch of things that come to mind for me when I think about the Peterson legacy. And actually, when I was writing that down, the Peterson legacy, wow, what an interesting statement, because if you've run with some of the Petersons for any amount of time, it's an adventure. It's always an adventure. There's rarely anything that we do is not, it's usually not simple. We overcomplicate things. We're stubborn. We have all this whole thing, and it's always just fun. And so there are a handful of things that just come to mind really quickly. One is the Peterson squint. I'm going to use it.
Yeah, that way the people online can get it.
Oh, that's good. Sorry about that. One thing is the Peterson squint. So if you're ever around all of us and you see a smile, we have this look about us. We come by it honestly. Uncle Frank, you've got it. Aunt Joyce, you've got it. My dad had it. And then so you have it too, so it's like double down in your family for sure. I mean, so you guys are just very honest. It's there. And you notice. And so the first time I saw grandkids, I'm like, oh, yep, Peterson. You can see it in that squint right away. And so one of the things you spoke so well on, thank you, is our sincere devotion to ice cream. We love our ice cream. My wife is amazed at how we blow through ice cream in my house. I watched my dad, Paul, sit, John sit and eat an entire carton in one sitting, straight out of the carton, and frustrate mom to no end. Why wouldn't you use them? Why wouldn't you put it in a bowl? And dad's like, why would I get a bowl dirty if I'm just going to eat the whole thing? And so I have to stash it in my house. I have to hide some, or else my kids will eat it. So a beautiful thing that we're handing down there, so I'm glad. I've heard rumors that there's ice cream, and I was going to be frustrated if there weren't ice cream here. You won't find a harder working man on the planet than Uncle John. Or Uncle Paul, I don't know. I would love to see him go at it right now. I think maybe the Lord called Uncle Johnny home because Dad's up there. I know you said those bricks are square, true and perfect. Dad might be making a mess of them up there, and he may have needed Uncle Johnny's help to kind of sort some of that out. And between the two of them, the Lord may be calling us all home soon, because we all may need to go up there and straighten both of those guys out. There is not, that square peg will go into that round hole. It always will. We just need a big enough hammer and enough effort. And that's the way Uncle Johnny was. And that's the way he lived. He would get it done. There was not an ounce of quit in him at all. Like, not an ounce. And so, again, I just see that in Dad. And so when I got the call about the accident, I was like, yeah. I know. It's heartbreaking, but I'm like, I know, because he didn't have an ounce of quit in him. Like, he was just going to do and doing stuff that they had, him and Dad both, they had no business doing half the things they did. But they were going to do them, and they would complete them, and they would do it, and they'd get it right, and it may take too long, or but they did it, and they didn't stop. And I think that's a phenomenal thing for us to learn from. It's like, how many times in my life have I been challenged by something, and I just want to quit, I want to give up? Fellas, we've had it modeled well for us. Like, we've had it modeled really well. Just don't quit. You also won't find a more generous human being. And I think that's true of all of you. Uncle Frank, I see it in you. Aunt Joyce, I see it in you. Big, burly, huge hands, we've talked about that. You could take Uncle Johnny's ring off of his finger, and I could fit two of my fingers in that ring. It was just massive. These big, hard-working hands. But in the midst of that was this kindness and this generosity that you're not going to find anywhere else. He'd give you the shirt off of his back. As I've said, Aunt Terry, I loved having him up in Georgia in January. It was just awesome. Like, my girls just adored him after like 2 minutes. And the funny stories that he told, and it was just incredible. Just so kind, so generous, getting to sit with him at dinner over and over again. And of course, we had to go to a buffet, and we had to eat way too much food. And it was awesome. So I could just share tons and tons of stuff. Love of fast cars. We haven't really talked about that much, but those Peterson boys have some fast cars in their bloodstream a little bit too. Food, ice cream, love of their pets, love of their family, especially that sweet granddaughter. Just a lot of incredible things. But something that I think is really important for us to hang on to is that Uncle Johnny had something that I think is really important, and that's hope. And he walked with hope, and he walked with purpose. And it's more than just being positive about life. It's a setting your mind on something bigger than yourself. And so I think it's our job, guys. So my brother and I would say, I'm in the same boat, man. I got to grab hold of those things from Dad and from Uncle Johnny. And those are our mantles to carry now. Like, we carry those things. We be hardworking. We be generous. We be kind. Maybe let's go to the doctor. Like, let's not do what they did and refuse to go to the doctor. Let's go to the doctor when we're supposed to. Let's not be so stubborn. But man, let's grab hold of those things that were so true of them. Just the generosity and the kindness and the hope and the purpose. I would share one scripture with you here real quick, because I love this so much. Matthew chapter 14, it tells about the death of John the Baptist. And so the disciples come to Jesus, and you could say John was a close friend. John the Baptist was a close friend of Jesus, maybe even his best friend. I don't know exactly, but they were really good friends. And so the disciples tell Jesus about this. And so when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. And I love that sentence in Matthew chapter 4, because it speaks to the humanity of who Jesus is. Now, understand, he is the incarnate Christ. He is God walking on this earth. There's absolute divinity within him.
But yet he pauses for a moment and he does what we do now. He grieves. He needs to be by himself and he needs to grieve and he needs to mourn. And so I think that's important because it speaks to the nature that God understands how, like, he understands what you're going through. He understands what you feel right now. He understands the hurt. He understands the loss. He understands all of those things. And so, a passage goes on and it says, but when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. And when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd and he had compassion on them and he healed their sick. And so it means we got to go back to work here, right? Tomorrow or the next day or next week, whatever it is. And at some point, Jesus did that too. I love the passage in Isaiah that spoke about that hope. That those who hope in the Lord, and it's finding that purpose, and it's finding that hope in something so much bigger than ourselves. The Apostle Paul writes to the church and tells them that he makes this statement. He says, our present troubles are small and won't last for very long. And I've always not struggled with that verse, but I'm like, Paul, what are you saying there? Like, because this present trouble that I have in front of me right now with losing another family member, it's not small. It's big. And won't last very long? Well, yeah, it's going to last forever. But Paul goes on to say that these moments produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. And so what he's talking about is a hope that is eternal. And so as we would grab hold of some things that speak to what we want to carry on from Uncle Johnny, like the kindness, the generosity, the hard work, the love of family, the love of pets, the love of people, all of those things, it's the Bible speaks about a life after this life. And thank you for sharing that with us. It's our existence up to this point is only this right now. And we can be tempted to think that this is all that there is. The Bible is incredibly clear that this is not all that there is. Either there's an existence with the God that we love and who loves us, it's a perfect existence, or it's separated from him. And that's not a good thing. One is better than we can possibly even imagine. And that's where Dad is. That's where Uncle Johnny is. That's where Uncle Happy is, who I'm named after, that I've never even met. That's where Grandma and Grandpa are, that I miss them too. And so it's better than we can possibly imagine. And God is very clear that the way to be with him forever, to be with them forever, isn't by us trying really hard to live this perfect life, or being really, really good, or being really, really kind, or not making any mistakes, or being perfect, or anything like that. It's like as if there's some way that you and I can live in a way that would merit, that would be good enough for us to be with God forever. That's not the case. We made that stuff up. Here's what God says to us. Here's where this hope is found that I think is so important that we cling to. It's a hope that I think that you and I have got to hold on to, and we've got to find the purpose in our life because it allows us to live the way Uncle Johnny lived. It allows us to live with the calm peace. You talked about that calm peace and assurance of what this life is all about. It's God says through Jesus Christ all throughout the Bible, he says, just trust me. Put your trust in me. Just ask me to rescue you, and I'll rescue you. It's so simple. In the midst of our brokenness, and my goodness, if you can't figure out that this world is broken right now, you're not paying attention. Like, we live in a broken place. And thankfully, we got guys like this that will help fix it. But it's broken even deeper than any of us can ever fix, and that's why we need a Savior. Just in the midst of your brokenness, in the midst of your fallenness, your flaws, your shortcomings, your mistakes, your imperfections, trust God. Put your trust in him. Put your hope in him. Find your purpose in him. And he promises to save you. He promises that life eternal is yours to have. And so I would end with this. Share stories. Whoever shared the story about the weather and being a weatherman, I want to hear that story. I do. Catch me at some point. I want to hear the story. Because as soon as you said it, I'm like, oh my gosh, it's just like my dad. I'm dying to know what that was. So share those stories. And I would encourage you to over the coming weeks, as a story pops into your mind, would you email Aunt Terry? And just, hey, this story popped in my mind. Would you carry those stories on? Because those are incredible nuggets for us of things that we didn't, like, I promise there are stories out there of Uncle Johnny that we have no idea. Just like when Uncle Johnny was standing at the house and he was going through the pictures with me, with Dad. So everything makes so much sense all of a sudden. We get to this one picture and there's this Chevy Impala. I don't know if you guys, this old Chevy Impala, this big boat of a car, convertible, right? This huge car, and so I'm looking at it, and it's got the body of like a 56 Corvette sitting on top of it. And I was like, Uncle Johnny, why'd you put that Corvette body on top of it, like just resting on top of it? I'm like, why would you store it there? And he looks at me kind of funny, he's like, we didn't store it there. I'm like, well, why is that on top of that? He goes, well, we drove to the junkyard in the Impala, bought that, and set it on top of the Impala, and crawled in and held on to it while we drove home. And I'm like, it all makes sense now. It all makes sense. Yes. That explains everything to me. So we as a family, like, we cherish those stories. I learned things about my dad. Uncle Johnny told me things about my dad that I'm like, oh my goodness, I had no idea. Hilarious stuff. And they were such treasures to me. That's why I had such a sweet, sweet time with him. And that's why it's so true for me. I'm so sorry that we have not been down here to hang out with you guys more often and share those stories together. Like, we've got to make that, like, my house is open to you guys up in Ohio. Anytime you want to come up, come on. Like, we will. It was only 65 degrees when we flew out last night, so it's so nice. What you guys have going on down here. Yeah, come on. Come on. So share those stories and cling to that hope and cling to something bigger than yourself, just like Uncle Johnny did. Like, find that, because your purpose is not going to be found in just being a good, kind, generous person. It was way more to Uncle Johnny than just that. It was rooted in a deep belief in who Jesus is in the midst of his life. So thank you for giving me a couple moments to share. I love you. I'm so, so sorry for you. My heart just, yeah. But I would say this is absolutely the best pulpit I've ever stood behind, because it fits. Like, it's right. It was him, it was them, and I just love this family. I think you guys are just all incredible, and I'm so proud of you. All right, Kelly, I think you're next.
Something over. Hi, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Kelly, and I've been lucky enough to call John my father-in-law. I'd like to just read something that I wrote after he passed. Can you guys hear me? Sorry, I'm not as loud. Okay. When I first started dating Mark, we of course talked and learned about each other's family members. This was about 12 years ago, but I remember things being said like, Billy is the really smart one. Johnny just moved to Tampa, he's gonna be a cop. My mom's a crazy coupon lady. But when it came to his dad, I specifically remember him describing his dad's hands before I was going to meet him. There they are. He said, they are big and scarred up from laying brick all his life, and they are about twice the size of mine. He's a big guy and looks really scary, but he is so quiet and nice, or something to that effect. At the time, I could never imagine just how important those hands were going to be to me in my life, but now I know. These are the hands of one of the hardest working men I have ever known. These hands provided for his family for decades, day after day working construction in the heat without a complaint. These hands have built so many buildings and structures throughout South Florida, including Marlins Park, where he proudly showed Noah his name displayed on the wall just recently. These hands have helped countless people with whatever they needed. Just ask any neighbor or friend. These hands have coached Little League and have thrown a baseball with all three of his sons. This one I might be biased. But these hands put up the best Christmas light display in all of Broward. I think many of you are familiar with the big star he would always put up. I think this is not even the star he would put up. I think he made like a giant one. These hands have pet all the dogs and kitties. Even the most timid dog or cat will go up to Poppy for pets. These hands never took a break even during retirement. I would always drive up to their house knowing Poppy was probably outside doing something like pulling weeds or sitting with Dakota Girl while she enjoyed watching TV, as he would call it. I loved to joke with him. I'd say, "Poppy, you're pulling weeds again?" And he'd usually reply with a witty remark like, "I gotta earn my dinner somehow." He was always doing or fixing something and was always at one of his son's houses doing something to help out. When Poppy heard something needed fixing, he was always there. Like my Uncle Dennis said, sometimes I would even go to Poppy first, even if I wanted something hung or fixed. I think much to Mark's annoyance. These hands have held our baby girl and made my heart melt every time I see him smile down at her. A literal gentle giant. So many thank yous I owe to this man. I can't even name them all. Thank you, Poppy, for helping fix all the things, from helping with Noah's nursery to all the work in the yard and just pretty much working on any project for the house with Mark. Thank you for planting orchids in the planter outside Noah's window. I promise I will try to take care of them and revive them even though I have a black thumb. You have helped make our house a home and I will forever be grateful. Thank you for loving your number one girl so much. Noah Rose will always love and know her Poppy. Thank you for taking Mark to work the other day when I left the house with the wrong set of keys, leaving him without a vehicle. Typical Kelly. That was the last time Mark saw you. Of course, you were doing something for us. But most of all, thank you for raising your son, my husband. He's the father he is today because of you, and I am beyond grateful for that. I couldn't have asked for a better example. I wish I could just sit next to you one more time while you show me all the things that you found on OfferUp, or all the things people have thrown up that you fixed, or just hear one more of your silly dad jokes. I miss you so much already. You have impacted my life in more ways than you will ever know. I find peace knowing you left this earth doing what you love, taking care of your home and your family. Now you can rest, eat your ice cream with Uncle Paul. We will take care of Mother and Dakota Girl, even though no one will come close to filling your shoes. I love you, Poppy.
So I'm Billy, the middle son. As I was trying to write these words down, there was so much I wanted to talk about, and I realized how long I was getting, and I realized I probably won't even be able to get some of these words out, but this is what I have. We all understand that death is an inevitable part of life, and its unexpected nature can leave us in shock. I am still in shock today. I would like to thank everyone that came out and express my heartfelt gratitude to everyone who has been incredibly supportive to my family during this challenging time. A special thanks to the McLeods and the Bardo family. If there is one thing in life my dad has taught me, it's me and my family, it's that we will be okay. He led by example and showed us that everything that life throws at you, all will be okay. One of those things that stood out most about my dad is how calm he was in any kind of situation. The best word I can use to describe him is he was chill. There was nothing you couldn't talk to him about. There was nothing that rubbed him the wrong way. There was nothing he complained about. There was never a moment I can ever remember that he lost his temper. He never tried to lecture me or any of my brothers. His actions always spoke louder than his words. He hardly ever cussed. He did have one phrase though. He did say sometimes when something wasn't working. And if you know what it was, you are among the very few. His presence made our lives remarkably simpler. Whenever something around the house needed fixing, all we had to do was call Dad. And he was there swiftly, coming to the rescue. Recently, I discovered a heartwarming aspect of my dad's thoughtfulness. My mom has never had to put gas in her car. He had a brewing system in place, a few 5-gallon cans that he always kept filled when he went to go get gas, ensuring that my mom's car was always full from the reserve. It wasn't something my mom asked him to do. He did it out of love and desire to make things simpler for all of us. His genuine joy came from finding ways to lighten our burdens and bring ease to our lives. He was always more than happy to accommodate anyone. A perfect example of this was my mom's love of watching soap operas. He would willingly sit on the couch and watch whatever she wanted to watch, immersing himself in her choice of entertainment. It was endearing to see how her enjoyment became his enjoyment too. Even when she wasn't home to watch a particular episode, he would still tune into it, eagerly waiting for my mom to come home so he can fill her in again. It was these little acts of kindness that made their bond so special and heartfelt. His selflessness knew no bounds, and he found joy in making those around him happy, even if it meant indulging in soap operas. The trait that stands out most about my dad is how selfless he was. Family meals was a perfect reflection of this beautiful quality. When they always ended, it ended in a delightful dilemma. You see, my mom instilled in us the value of never wasting food, while my dad taught us the importance of thinking of others before ourselves. These two lessons collided at the dinner table, creating a heartwarming yet amusing predicament. Picture this. We're sitting together, enjoying a meal as a family. Let's say we're having pizza. We had reached the last slice of pizza in the box, and suddenly it felt like a contest of politeness and selflessness. Each of us, my dad, Johnny, and Mark, and myself, would quietly eye that last slice of pizza, wanting it, but unwilling to claim it for ourselves at the expense of others. My dad never once reached for that final slice of pizza. He watched with a smile as me and my brothers tried to figure it out. The only times my dad ever got that last part of the meal was when we could not finish it. We had to physically convince him by putting it on his plate in front of him. Now as me and my brothers continue our lives' journeys, we strive to follow in my dad's footsteps, caring for his legacy of kindness and compassion to avoid future dilemmas. I have a simple solution for Johnny and Mark. Just place a name tag next to that pizza that says Billy. Not a single soul in this room can deny that my dad will go above and beyond for anyone. And not only would he do it, he would do it exceptionally well. But when it came time to repay him for his acts of kindness, good luck. He simply wouldn't accept anything. He performed his acts of generosity from the pure kindness of his heart, finding fulfillment in helping others without seeking anything in return. It took me many years to figure out a way around this, but he did have a love for collecting his coins. Often he would ask me to order some of his coins through the mint, and then a brilliant idea struck me. I saw that they had a subscription service where you can sign up for the coins on the release and have them mailed to you. So I quickly signed up for that. Now whenever my dad came over and lent a hand around the house, I'll hand him a coin as a token of appreciation for his help. He insisted that he didn't need anything in return, but I'll playfully reply to him, "Well, Dad, I bought this coin and I don't know what to do with it. What's its face value?" And then he took the coin. He sure loved his coins. If you had the privilege of knowing my dad, you would understand the sheer dedication he had towards his hard work. His work ethic was unmatched. Even in his 70s, he could outwork me. During his time in construction, he was a force to be reckoned with, quick, efficient, and full of energy. A single laborer couldn't keep up with him. They had to assign multiple laborers to match his pace and keep him satisfied. He had a dislike of idleness. He despised sitting around and doing nothing, and it bothered him to be on the job site without actively working. His craftsmanship and hard work are evident all around our house. A simple walk from his house from the front to the backyard will reveal his handiwork in every corner, from the mailbox, the driveway, the front porch, to all the doors and windows, to tile throughout the house, to the back porch, all the brick outside the back of the house, to the grill area, to the pavers down by the pole, all stood a testament to his skills. The list can go on and on and on. But not to forget, what I think the most impressive of all is the seawall that he built down by the lake. Not only our house, not only his house, but my house and my brother's houses as well. Even all around South Florida, his work is here. From a small bank to a large stadium. And as I think Uncle Dennis described, the wall on the Marlins Park. He always loved to go by that wall and show off his name to us. Another valuable lesson my dad instilled in us and me was the importance of punctuality. Being on time was an essential part of his character. He never kept anyone waiting. Whenever it was picking me up, giving me rides from school to work, he was always there, waiting patiently. It became a little game I played with myself, trying not to make him wait. I'll tell him I'll be getting out later than usual, than I actually would. But even then, he'd always still be there waiting for me. The trade certainly has taught me and was put to the test just a few months ago when we had to make it to the cruise in Vancouver. Long story short, we made it just on time. Now these 8 blocks in front of us represents a story that was told to me that I still can't believe today. I would have had my uncle here to confirm the story, but unfortunately he's sick and not able to come. But the story goes, I was over at my uncle's house after one of the hurricanes for one summer, this probably 10, 15 years ago, and I was helping repair his roof. There was a friend of my uncle's, his name was Ray. I believe Ray was a general contractor. He was a small guy, as nice as can be, but also likes to talk a lot bigger than he is. When he found out who I was, he said he knew my dad and needed to tell me a story. The story goes as follows. My dad was at my uncle's house, laying block in the back of his house, and Ray had come over, talking as he would, and would say to my dad, oh, those brick look straight, your mortar lines look good, but can you carry your own block? My dad turned around and looked at Ray and said, can you carry 8 block? Ray responded, yeah, with the wheelbarrow. All my dad did was get up, took out his wallet, took out a $100 bill, and put it down, not saying anything else, and then proceeded to stack 8 blocks, 1 vertically, 3 stacked on top, 2 sets of them, and then he took the blocks and carried them across the yard. And Ray, during this whole time, was saying, we didn't bet, we didn't bet, we didn't bet. But that was my dad. If anyone wants to come up on stage and try to carry these blocks all at once, feel free. I think if anyone can do it, they would need a prize or something. In that story Uncle Dennis talked about with him buying deodorant, my mom's phrase of him buying the deodorant, it wasn't just one deodorant, it was a lifetime supply. So whoever can carry the 8 block, you deserve a lifetime supply of deodorant. Thank you.
Thank you. celebrate my dad, my dad's life, and thank you, Uncle Dennis, for allowing me to speak. And I guess, even though you recently retired, spreading God's word really doesn't have an end to it, does it? Okay. Since my dad has passed, I enjoyed, and this is kind of like what my cousin Happy just said, since my dad has passed, I've enjoyed talking to people about him and hearing stories about him. If any of you out here have any story about my dad at some point, whether it's today or another day, please, please, please share it with me. I would absolutely love to hear it. Sorry. So I'm not going to repeat the story about the block, but since my brother talked about it, it's one of the favorite stories I've heard too. And when I heard the story, even I couldn't believe that it was true. So that very day when I heard the story, I went back home, I talked to my dad. I said, "Dad, is it true that you can carry 8 block at one time?" And without even mentioning the $100 bill thing, my dad goes, "You got $100?" And then another story I enjoyed hearing was when my mom's mom, my grandma Grams, was around. She would tell me stories about how when my dad would go up to Dairy Queen, and my grandma could know, she could tell the days when my mom worked when my dad went up there, and days when my mom worked when my dad didn't go there. My grandma would tell me that my mom would come home and always say, "Corvette came by again today." Call him Corvette came by. So there's no doubt that my dad was proud of me and my brothers Billy and Mark. Slightly more proud of me because I was his favorite son. But I don't have to tell you all that, you probably already know. And he was the first to talk about any accomplishments we had. Out of all the accomplishments, awards, ranks, titles, additions to my name, the one I am most proud of is the one that I didn't even earn. I stand here before you today wearing my dad's shirt, my dad's pants, my dad's belts, my dad's socks, and my dad's boots.
What about the underwear?
Wearing my own. They are candy cane ones, though. I stand here before you today wearing his clothes, saying that I am proud to be named after my dad, John Noel Peterson Jr. Okay, well, maybe I did earn that name a little bit by being a fast swimmer. President Theodore Roosevelt once said, "Speak softly and carry a big stick." Don't worry, Dad, I'm comparing you to a Republican. Regardless of what that meant back then, when it comes to my dad, I think this quote describes him perfectly. He never wanted to be the center of attention, never did he yell at me, my brothers, or even my mom. He was the hardest working man and had the hands that can carry the biggest stick. Those hands carried me from birth, and he used those hands to pave a path to be the ultimate family man and my role model. When my brothers and I were younger, Billy and I, we would just be minding our own business, playing video games or something, and then Mark would go running to my mom for no apparent reason whatsoever, and if I'm lying, say something. For no apparent reason ever, saying that we were bothering him or whatnot or whatever, and my mom would take out this big metal ruler that she had, and she would start beating us with it. It's okay. Florida law allows it even to this time. So, and after my mom would hit us with the big old metal or wooden ruler, I would remember telling her, "Oh, that didn't hurt." And she, boom, "That didn't hurt." And then she would say, "Wait till your father gets home with his belt." Oh, that hurt. But the funny thing is, I don't ever remember my dad taking off his belt and actually hitting spanking us with it. He never punished us. He did what any man that could carry a big stick should do. He provided for us. He paved a path for us. He never once told us to follow it, never told us we should go to college. But we all did and put the three of us through as much as college as we wanted without having us to pay for it ourselves. He never pressured us to succeed in life, but we all did. He never once told us to move out after a certain age. I even lived at home until around 26, and I didn't even really want to move out, neither desired to. My dad was always home and always there for us, from waking us up in the morning for school, to coming to all of our baseball games, and even coaching some of our teams, and going to sporting events, even driving up to Tampa and bringing me down before our recent Alaska trip. My dad would never even tell us no. Whenever we asked him something, what would he always tell us?
Ask your mother.
Go ask your mom. Besides the walls and the roof at my parents' house, those hands left his fingerprints all over the place. Not only at his house, but he's probably done more work at my house and my brother's houses each than what we've done combined. Whenever my dad would come to my house to watch the dogs while Katie and I went on vacation, we would come back and my dad would have the yard freshly cut, trees trimmed, driveways pressure washed. Even if I cut the grass the day before he came up, I'd tell him no, the grass is already cut, and he would always still do it. My neighbors would even tell me, your dad does nothing but work all day. And I would tell him, that's my dad. My dad had the best decorated house for Christmas. He brought so much joy to not only our family but to everyone. He had the best decorated house at Christmas, better than anyone on the block. People would drive up to the house and tell him, how did you get that star up in that tree? Which you could see from miles and miles and miles. My dad's classic response, I either climb the tree or I'm Superman. That star in the tree brought so much joy to people, and it's kind of fitting that it's the ending of my dad's story. That decorated tree brought so much joy to everyone, but yet it caused so much grief to us in the end, and I think it kind of symbolizes the way how he would take off his shirt, off his back, and put everyone before himself. I have daily reminders every day of my dad when I look in the mirror. Like my good looks, my full head of soon-to-be gray hair. I'm sure Mark thinks the same. When he sees his already full head of gray hair. When Billy looks into the mirror, he probably thinks about some crazy complex math equation on how much time he has left before he goes bald. which makes me question, Mom, how did he get so smart? Not only is my dad, but he's my role model. Even though I look like him, I wanted to be just like him. My love for family and my wife came from my dad from the love my dad had for all of you and my mom. My love for sports came from my dad I remember him taking me to my first sporting event. It was a Dolphins versus Jets game. I was probably way too young to go to a Dolphin game at that time. And my dad would always tell me after the game, I would do nothing but chant, Jets suck. And it's funny, after all these years, they still do. My love for Chevrolets came from my dad. My first car was a Monte Carlo because my dad drove a Monte Carlo. My dad traded in his Chevrolet Silverado he had one day for an Equinox so he could more comfortably drive around his family of five. That same day my dad bought the Chevrolet Equinox was a pretty cool day. I also sold my Monte Carlo to Mark and bought myself a Chevrolet Camaro the same exact day from the same dealership from the same guy that my dad did. I later traded in that Chevrolet Camaro for a Chevrolet Trailblazer so I can comfortably drive my family of four around. Shout out to Poppy's number one boys, Conan and Leo. I would always ask my dad if he wanted me, to get him any tickets for the Strawberry Festival raffle, where they were raffling away a Chevrolet Corvette every year. And every time I would text him and ask him if he wanted me to buy him a ticket, the classic response, just the winning one. One day I'm gonna get my first Corvette too, but it won't be the same since I won't be able to give you a ride like that. Speaking of Poppy's number ones, Poppy's number one girl, as he would say, Nora Rose Peterson. I have no memories of my grandfathers or stories to recall about them. I stood on this very stage a few years ago promising to help you guide your faith in God. And I stand here today promising you, I will make sure you always have stories to hear about how proud of a papa you have. And like how the last picture ever taken with me and my dad was also with you, showing you where his name is and will forever be enshrined at Marlins Park for being a part of the construction crew there. And I'll even make sure you remember the Donald Duck voice he used to do, because I can do it too. I have nothing but good memories about my dad. There isn't a single bad one. The memories will last forever. I strive to provide the world with the kindness you provided it. I will forever admire you and your daily acts of unselfishness and putting everyone before yourself. I will miss all your dad jokes, your magic tricks, going to sporting events, watching sports on TV, and just sitting on the couch eating too much ice cream. You are the best dad I could have ever asked for. You are always around for everything, always home, and always there for us. Although some may say you left the world early, you left on your own terms, doing what you like, doing what you did best, just like your brother Uncle Paul. You looked up to your brothers and were close to your brothers and sister. Shout out to you, Aunt Joyce, I know you're watching. As I hope my brothers look up to me, and the bond I have with my brothers is just as strong as yours. Special shout out to you, Uncle Frank, for being the longest surviving Peterson brother. Who would have thought of it? Just proving, it's for you too, Happy. Just proving the oldest Peterson brother is the best one of them all. The last text message I ever sent my dad was Happy Father's Day. Thank you for being such a great dad. I love you. Later that same day, I called him too, because I'm not just going to text my dad on Father's Day. I'm going to call him. And I talked to him. And that was the actual last day that I got to talk to him. The last time I saw my dad was at Noah's second birthday. And before I left, as I always did, I gave him a big hug, and I said, I love you, Dad. Thank you for everything.
Just so you guys know, that's my wedding ring. You could barely fit his pinky. That's all that he came to work. I'm all right. I just want to thank you all for coming. I'm the youngest. My dad wouldn't want the attention, but he chose everybody's heart in this room. In a unique way. I'm going to miss so many things about my dad. I wish to share some stories about him. First, I want to tell you about the time my mother went on strike for a few days and didn't cook anything, and we all know how much the Petersons love to eat.
I remember one early morning, at 5 a.m., my dad and I were looking inside the fridge, looking for something to eat. I remember my dad saying, "Your mother is mad at me." I looked at him and said, "I think we all need to figure that out by now, because it's been a couple of days." He pulled out his wallet and gave me a few bucks to go get something. I smiled at him and I said, "Not to worry about it." But looking back, he was just putting us first. He always put us first, because that's who he was. Before he got married and had us three boys, my dad was a cool guy with Corvettes. My mom would call him Corvette Guy when he would get his strawberry shake at Dairy Queen. But when he drove his truck, my mom didn't recognize him. I always asked why he sold his Corvettes, and he always would tell me, "I traded three Corvettes in for three songs." I would always reply, "That's a bad deal." He loved his Corvettes, but he definitely loved his three sons and his wife a lot more. I believe he knew he won that trade in every way imaginable. My dad left me with so many great memories, from driving me up and down the East Coast so I could play baseball tournaments. These tournaments would always involve rain delays, and while the guys who usually maintain the fields would be in their sheds not doing anything, my dad would be out there with his pump, pumping out the rainwater from these fields. He was always trying to help. His joy of putting Christmas lights up, sitting on the front porch with Dakota, always coming over to fix something, laying papers in the backyard, I could go on and on. Even the day before he passed away. Kelly gave me a gift that day and grabbed a long set of keys. So who did I call? My dad, to pick me up so I could get to work. I can't even think of a single bad memory of my dad. Now who wouldn't want a father like that? I'm glad he was my dad. I think the hardest part about living before is the memories we didn't get to live together. I'm talking about the ones of his number one girl, Noah Rose. Man, I wish I had more time to see Noah grow up and play. My dad's face lit up when we were both together. He has so many things planned. I knew one of his plans, which involved the old Coke machine on my parents' back porch that he recently fixed, and told me, "When Noah gets older, I want to give her 2 quarters. So she can buy herself and Poppy a Coke." I really wish I could see that happen, but I promise I will restock that Coke machine for you, Dad. Make sure Noah buys herself and you a Coke in your honor. I love you, miss you, Dad.
Memories, stories, healing. The Lord Jesus is there right through it all. May that what today be about. We stand now as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, because God has made us his people through baptism and Christ, living together in trust and hope, we confess now our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we pray, Almighty God, grant to us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can change, and the wisdom to know the difference. Have mercy, O God, on John's family and friends, that by your tender ministries they may draw day by day on your strength, until at last each of them realizes your healing power and their grief is relieved. We give you thanks for John and all that he has been to all assembled. As a friend, husband, father, grandfather, neighbor, fixer of all things, mason, layer, bricklayer, co-worker, a giver of joy. We especially thank you for his helpfulness and love and direction that he would give when physical or spiritual life ills beset anyone, and for his abundant love even in the face of adversity, and his willingness to often see beyond problems to solutions. We are thankful for supportive friends and co-workers and neighbors who will lend their support in the days and weeks and years to come to this family. O God, whose own Son, Jesus Christ, died a terrible death, you know the full anguish of human suffering and loneliness. It's never your intention that a person should die, even as you share the nightmare, our grief gently awaken us to a new Easter dawn of resurrection, hope, and life. And then together with John and all who sleep in you and all who wait for you on earth, we shall rejoice in your eternal salvation given to us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. And together we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, John Peterson. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in life. Amen. Let us go forth in peace, in the name of Christ. Amen. You may be seated for a moment. The service continues, the celebration of life continues, and it'll be, as you go through the glass doors down the hall, down the long hall to the cafeteria. But before we go, we need to introduce Noah Rose, his number one girl. I think she's sleeping right now. But this is Noah Rose, and as we know, Noah's fighting TCI. TSC, I say it wrong every time.
That's okay.
But, and in lieu of flowers today and stuff, the family's asked that we would, if we remember your child, we would give gifts to, so that Noah can get her help that she needs in the days and weeks and years to come. And so please keep her in your prayers.
We appreciate everybody that's been showing so much support. I know he's smiling down, knowing this girl's taken care of, so thank you.
Thank you. And let's, as there's a meal being served, well, let's have a prayer for that. Lord, as we gather together around food and drink, may you bless this time of stories and memories of John, and may you give us strength to know that each day is a gift for you, and may we live it in the present. So bless this food to nourish us, in Jesus' name, amen. I'm not one of those guys that leaves. But today I'm leaving because I have a funeral in 15 minutes at another place. So receive the benediction now. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. And thank you for being here. And may the love of Jesus live in our hearts today and always. In Jesus' name, amen. And we close with this final hymn. And afterwards, feel free to make your way down to the cafeteria.
Pain is gone and mercy fills the streets.
I gotta go, I'll be back.
to take me and walk with him for all eternity. With one more.